Okie dokie. Grade 12 applied 1 May 2017. Where was everybody today? Anyway, I'm going to race through this since you should have done it all yourself already. Anyways, right, so there was the battle plan for this date. If you weren't here, you got a lot of work to do. Probability. We'll learn about ore, but we're going to do warm-up first. And a handout on an assignment. You only got a couple days to do these. If you don't get it in, it only gets half marks. And after a week, it gets no marks. I hope you know that. Next slide. So we've done this lot. This is called integers. Integers are a type or a species of number. They happen to include positive numbers and negative numbers. So we started with positive numbers when we were counting sheep 4,000 years ago. And then somebody said, well, if you owe me some sheep, that would be a negative number. So negative numbers are pretty much bad things. Right, so I hope you know that. Right, I hope you know how to do these. Right, 5 plus 9 is 14. 5 below 0, and then 9 above 0 is 4 above 0. 9 plus. I hope you know how to do these. I'm not going to explain them to you. Oh, there's the one that people mess up all the time. All right, so here, I guess I will explain them to you one last time. We did a lot of this in grade 10. We did a lot of this in grade 11. Here we go. All right, let's do it one last time. Integers. Integers are positive things and negative things. Good things and bad things, right? Did you know that 5 good things, and if I throw 5 good things into my day, or into my hat, and then if I throw 9 good things into my day, or into my hat, guess what? I've got 14 good things. I love good things. All right, so that's easy. I think most people know how to count like that. What if I said, I have 5 bad things, so that's a negative number. That's 5 below 0, and then I add 9 good things. Well, look, there's 5 negative things, so I'll throw them in my hat. And here's 9 positive things. So if I have 5 negative things and I have 9 positive things and I throw them in my hockey sock, and I hope you know that a good thing cancels a negative thing. So we'll do a little canceling here. Positive cancels a negative. Boom, boom. Boom, boom. Boom, boom. All right. And what am I going to be left with? Looks like I'm left with 4 things. Isn't that amazing? So you could say that 5 bad things, or negative 5 plus 9 is 4. I think most people know that. If you don't know how to do this because you don't know what temperatures and golf scores are like, then just learn how to do it on your calculator. But you gotta know how to handle negative numbers, all right? I think most people realize that 5 bad things, 5 negative things, plus 9 good things, it leaves you with 4 good things. And notice this is not a subtract. You don't say subtract 5 plus 9. Anytime you say subtract 5, you gotta go, well, what am I subtracting it from? So you can't say this is a subtract 5. This is called a negative 5. It's 5 below 0. It's 5 that you owe somebody, that when you get 5, you got to give to somebody to get you up to 0. You might want to think about what a negative number is. But if you got a debit card, you would know that a negative number is a debt or a debit. So this is the one that freaks people. Oh, this one's not too bad. Sorry. 9 plus a negative 5. Well, that's no different than the very last one we did. Because it turns out the order in which you do things, if you count your positive things first and your negative things after that, the commutative law, of addition, says that when you add things together, it doesn't matter what order you add things together. So you can throw the negatives in first and then the positives, and you still end up with the same answer. So whether you count the bad things first and the good things next, or the good things first, and the, you still end up with the same answer. And, of course, I hope everybody knows that this answer here is 4. And, of course, anytime you got just a number, there's an implied or an unwritten positive in there. So we're still talking about integers, and I hope everybody knows that 9 subtract or 9 take away 5 or 5 less than 9. There's a zillion ways to say that. Well, maybe 5 ways to say it. Now, this is the one that will freak you out. This is the one you'll screw up most often. I don't know why. If you just remember one simple idea, it's not that tough. All right, this says 5 take away a negative 9. Notice I put the negative this time. I squirted it up in the corner to make it look more like a negative number as opposed to a subtract, because you don't want to write something like that. You wouldn't want to have 5 subtract, because that, you go, what does that mean, right? So usually we squirt it up in the corner like that. Not always. And often we put it in brackets, too. That way it stands out that it's a standalone package of negative 9s. You don't have to have the brackets there, but personally I prefer to put them there, and then it stands out that you got a whole package of negative stuff. Okay, watch this. All right, so I'm going to give you 5 things, all right? I hope you know, if you're an adult, well, I think a puppy knows this. A 3-week-old puppy knows that if you take away bad things, that's good. Taking away bad things is the same as adding good things. Did you ever realize that? Ask your 3-week-old puppy. Puppies know that taking away bad things is good. All right, so let's try taking away some negatives. All right, so I'm going to give you 5 things. You ready? Here's 5 good things. You're going, huh? Yeah, I'm giving you 5 good things. Look at that. I gave you 5 good things. Look, that entire package there is 5 good, once you allow for the negatives canceling the positives. All right, so that entire black box there was 5 good things, right? Notice how those 9 reds would cancel those 9. Those 9 negatives would cancel those 9 positives. So really, all you'd have is 5 positives. So this entire package is worth 5 positives. And now I'm going to say, okay, so I got 5 positives, and I'm going to take away 9 negatives. Watch, I'm going to take away 9 negatives. If you don't understand this, just rewind it. I'm going to take away 9 negatives. Here they go. Come on. Boom, 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 boom. Look at that. I had 9 negatives. I took away 9 negatives, and now I'm left with 14. Isn't that amazing? Did you ever notice that subtracting bad things is the same as adding? Taking away negatives is the same as adding. And the way some teachers teach it is you just go like this, right? You write it down, and then you just take all the subtractings and the negatives and turn them into addings and positives. Because taking away negatives is the same as adding positives. If you do not understand that, stop now and rewind and try it again. Taking away negatives is the same as adding positives. I proved it to you. So to subtract a negative, to subtract an integer, all you do is you add the opposite. You might want to write that down. Well, in fact, it's already on your red sheet that I gave you 6 months ago. If you want to subtract integers, you add, right? Here's a subtract, so you add. It was a negative, so you make it positive. In other words, you take a negative. Taking away a negative is the same as adding a positive. Rewind this and watch it 10 times if you have to. Or if you don't want to do that, just put it in your calculator. Your plastic brain knows how to do this. But preferably you'd know how to work without your plastic brain. All right. Anybody know what 9 times 5 is? Technically, this isn't 9 times 5. Technically, this is 5 nines. So this is the multiplier. This is how many of those you have, technically speaking. It turns out it doesn't matter. But it turns out that technically this is the multiplier. So it really means you got 5 nines added together, which I think most people realize is 45. That's why you memorize your timetables, so you don't have to add all the time. Okay, so what is using that logic? If I said you got 5 negative nines added together, you'd say, well, that's a negative 9 added to another negative 9 added to another negative 9 added to another and another negative 9, and you'd say, well, hold, that's a lot of negatives. I'm having a crappy day. But you could add all those negatives together, and then you'd realize that, oh, that's just negative 45. So if you just think of it that way, that's, there's other silly rules you can remember, but that's pretty obvious if you ask me. Next slide. Engage. All right. Let's evaluate. Evaluate means to give a value. Evaluate. Value. And I'm going to give you an expression like 2 times an x, and then I'm going to say, oh, by the way, the x is worth 5. Can you tell me what the expression is worth? All right, so 2 times x, and if I tell you the x is really 5, doesn't that mean 2 times some number, and I tell you the number is 5, so you got 2 times 5. And normally when I plug in values, I like to use brackets. That way it stands out, all the numbers that you're plugging in, right? And that way it makes it easier to go back and plug in other numbers later. Right, so 2 times, I think the answer is 10. How about Z? Some number added to 4. And then somebody says, oh, but I know what the number is. It's 4. So you got 4, usually in brackets, plus 4. You don't have to use brackets, but if you don't, you'll start to lose track of where the unknown was. Z less 3, or Z take away 3, or 3 less than Z. Right, whatever you want to say for that expression, and I think you know that that's a 4 minus a 3 is going to be 1. Now notice that Z subtract 3 is not the same as 3 subtract Z. It's not the same for subtract. So 3 subtract 4 is not the same as 4 subtract 3. Because having $1 is not the same as owing $1. 1 degree above 0 is not the same as 1 degree below 0. I hope you know that. Let's try. Oh, look, we got a plug in for the X and for the Z. So we got 2 nickels and a 4. So you always do the multiplying first, plus the 4, looks like about a 14. How about if I said 5 Z's, take away 2 Z's? Well, wouldn't you just say that that's 3 Z's? Or you could use lots of numbers instead and say, well, that's 5 4's, take away 2 4's. And you'd say, well, that's the same as 20, take away 8, which is the same as 12. But wouldn't it have been easier in the very beginning to realize that 5 Z's take away 2 Z's is 3 Z's, and 3 times a 4 is 12? That's called that distributive law, if you know what I'm talking about. All right, if you don't worry. Your plastic brain will do it for you if you want to let it do your thinking. Here we go. Oh, man, now I'm getting really fancy. This is called polynomial addition, if you remember that back in your grade 9, 8. Anyway, if I said 3x add 2 z's, add 4 of some other number of the same z, and then take away one package of x, you could say, well, hold on. Isn't 3 packages of x take away one package of x just 2 packages of x? And isn't 2 Z's plus 4 Z's really 6 packages of Z? So you could simplify this by grouping together the like terms, right? This is 3 jars of pickles, take away 1 jar of pickles. And this is 2 boxes of cookies plus 4 boxes of cookies. So you just combine the like things. So you could have made it simpler and then plugged in the numbers. That would have been so much easier. unless you want to just do it the long way. So I end up with 34 as the answer there. Oh, how about this one? That's a legal number, too. Technically, that's not an integer. That's actually called a fraction. It's called a rational number because we made a ratio with two other numbers. If you don't like fractions, then just do it on your calculator, right? Isn't that 2 times 5 is 10, and 3 quarters of 4 things is really 3 things, isn't it? Boom, boom, cancel. The answer is 7, for goodness sake. Right? Just put it in the plastic brain if you don't know how to do it. 2 times 5, subtract 3, divided by 4, times 4. The plastic brain will tell you that it's 7, all right? If you can't do fractions, use the plastic brain. If you can't do algebra, use the plastic brain. If you can't do integers, use the plastic brain. Here, solve. 2x plus 1 equals 9. All right, so you could guess, right? You know right away the answer is 4, isn't it? Did it take you long to guess that? But we don't guess anymore, do we? So you're going to say backwards. You're going to say, well, what did I have before somebody added this 1? So obviously you had 8. So you're working backwards. And then you say, so what did I have before somebody doubled my x? And you say, well, the way to undouble something is to divide it by 2, or break it into 2 piles. And that means 1x is worth 4. So there, that's like the only rule there is to this game is you do the same thing to both sides to whittle down the x all by itself. Whatever it takes to whittle it down. You cannot screw up this game. Not only that, you don't even need an answer key, because you take your answer, you plug it back in and evaluate, and you see if it gives you a true statement. Hey, 2 fours plus a 1 is 9. Oh, let's follow the same steps on this. Okay, now this was one of the students doing it, so I'll race through that, because she made it a little more complicated than I would. I mean, it's perfectly right, but in fact, they came up with the same answer, all right? But I'm going to show you my way. So I like to rewrite the problem. I don't like to mess up the original problem because then you lose track of what you were doing. So I usually rewrite the entire original question. I would suggest you do the same. So let's follow the same steps as we did here. If you understood this, then what the heck is the difference here? All right, so you're going to say, all right, first thing I'm going to do is subtract the 2. Which means I'm going to have 3 quarters of an x must have been 15, right? I'm not going to show you that I took away 2, for God's sake, all right? I guess I am. There you go. Now I want to get rid of this 3 quarters. What did we do here? To get rid of the 2 that was multiplying, we divided by 2. So I'm going to divide both sides by 3 quarters. So if I divide by 3 quarters, divide by 3 quarters, well, I hope you know that 3 quarters divided by 3 quarters is really just 1. Anytime you divide by yourself, you end up with 1. So you end up with x is, don't forget, to divide a fraction, you flip and multiply. So you're going to turn it into a 4 thirds. The divide becomes a multiply. When you flip this, you end up with 60 divided by 3 is equal to 20, which is the same as that other good student had. My way's a little bit easier, and it follows the steps I showed you here. Next slide. All right, now we can get really funky. All right, if you don't like this for sure, don't worry. The plastic brain will do it. Here we go. Now, there's a little bit of a trick to this, all right? But I'll show you the... I'll show you the one pattern that I showed you before. Don't I subtract 1/8 from both sides? So if I subtract 1/8 from both sides, oh man. And then you got to realize that 5/12 is really the same as, 5/12 is really the same as 15/24, and this is really the same as 3/24. So this would, this would be 10/24, and this will be 3/24, and 10 minus 3 is 7/24. If you don't know how to do fractions, just do that on your calculator. It will tell you what the answer is as a fraction. So now we got 2/3 of the x is equal to 7/24. And of course, how do I get rid of that 2/3? Well, what did we do every other time? If a multiplying thing was messing you up, don't you divide by it? So divide both sides by 2/3, because it magically disappears. And how do you divide a 7/24 by 2/3? You flip and you multiply. Oh my goodness. All right, and then you end up with, there you go. You end up with 21/48, which is 7/16. Use your calculator if you can't do fractions. Yeah. Now, I'll show you a trick to this. It turns out I could, if you didn't like working with fractions, get rid of the fractions. You ready? Here you go. All right, here we go. So all you really had to do was, I'm going to multiply both sides by 24. Notice that I can make 24 using 3s, I can make 24 using 8s, and I can make 24s using a 12. So I'm picking a 24, because watch what happens. If I multiply both sides by 24, I'm just going to make the problem. I'm going to blow up the problem. I'm going to make it look 24 times bigger. It's a lot easier to solve things when they're nice and big. Who the heck wants an eighth? Right? You want to blow it up. So if I multiply both sides, as long as you multiply both sides by the same number, it still balances. All right, 24 times 2 divided by 3 is 16. Hope you can do that in your head. And 24 divided by 8 is 3. All right, so there you go. And this ends up being 24, 12 is going to be 2, is going to be 10. So this side here is 10. Ah, does this look easier to solve now? Yeah, no fractions. Take away 3 off both sides, divide by 16. Bada bing, bada boom. Looks like the x is going to be 7/16. Which is pretty much the same thing as we said before. Okay, so I think the steps here are really, really easy. We've done the same thing over and over and over. The numbers got harder, but the steps were the same. If you really decline to learn that stuff, the plastic brain will do it for you. Here you go, watch this. Boom. So we'll do it on the plastic brain. You might not actually like this better, to be honest. This might actually be harder. So what you do is you type in the first equation, right, 2/3 of the x plus 1/8, and then you type in the right side, 5 divided by 12, 5/12, and you go bing, and you graph them. Where's the graph? Boom. So there's that line there, and there's that line there. So you make two lines, and you find out where they cross. And they cross right there. So that line there, that's a drawing of 2/3 of an x plus 1/8. And this is a drawing of a nice constant 5/12. And when does this equal this? When does 2/3 x plus 1/8 equal that? Boom. And your plastic brain will tell you that it's right there. And then you turn that into a decimal, and look, you get the same answer. Isn't that magic? It turns out that this is actually harder than learning the algebra. But this is how we do it in applied math. So if your algebra really bites, you can still graph it and come up with the answer. But I'm telling you, it's probably easier, seriously, to learn the algebra. At least for this type of question. There do exist problems that cannot be solved using algebra. You actually have to find out what the picture looks like to figure out the answer, but this is certainly not one of the ones where you need to have a picture. Next slide. All right, so if Trevor has a 5 out of 18 probability of winning a certain prize for his girlfriend, if he tries 18 times, how many times should he expect to win? Duh. Right, isn't it 5 times? So the probability of a win is equal to 5 out of 18. So probability is calculated by calculating the number of what you want, or wins, compared to the number of times you try. And if you didn't write even the formula down, then you're just not even trying. There's only one formula for probability, right? How to calculate probability. Why wouldn't you write it down? So you write down the formula. You plug in the numbers. So 5 out of 18 is some number of wins out of 18. Can you? Let's see. 5 out of 18 is the same as how many out of 18? I wonder what the number is. Do you feel kind of silly now? Right? He's going to win 5 times, probably. Oh, my goodness. But if you're not even writing down the formula, oh, man. Right? What are the odds in favor of him winning? Right? Now, of course, remember that odds are slightly different. So odds are calculated by the number of times you win compared to the number of times you don't win. Make sure you got that on your cheat sheet. That's win versus don't win. But goodness sake, if you don't even bother to write down a formula off your cheat sheet or my cheat sheet or off the board that's up in front of you or out of your notes, what are you doing? Next slide. Let's try this. Let's flip a coin. All right, so there's 4 separate independent questions here. And, of course, this involves pretty much that formula. So what's the probability of flipping ahead and then ahead and then ahead? All right, ahead, then ahead, then ahead. Well, I guess what? Ahead on the first coin, ahead on the second coin, ahead on the third coin. The rule is it's you just multiply the individual probabilities together. If they are independent like that, you just multiply, well, it doesn't matter whether you multiply the probabilities together. You got a half a chance, or 0.5 for those of you who like decimals. You got another half a chance, or another 0.5, which is technically 5/10, and another 0.5, or half rather. And you know what? I'm much more comfortable with fractions. That's a 1 in the top and an 8 in the bottom. 1 in the top. 8 in the bottom. I'm picturing a 1 slice of an 8 slice pizza. Or you can work in fractions and find out that it's 0.125, which really means 125 slices of a 1,000 slice pizza. Because that number there is 125 thousandths. Right? So I would much rather picture that than a 1,000 piece pizza and I'm eating 125 of the slices. I don't like decimal numbers. Or you could convert it to 12.5%. Or, all right, so if you weren't sure how to calculate it, you could have drawn a sample space. So you could have had on the first flip a head and a not head. And you could have had a head and a not head. Or you could have had a head and a not head. And that's the first 2 flips. And then the third flip would be a head and a not head, a head and a not head. And it looks like there's going to be 8 branches to this thing. All right, so there's all the possible. Which one of those branches is all heads? Boom, boom. There's only one branch that's all heads. There's only one branch that's all heads, and it's right there, the top branch. Right? We only care. So there's only one out of the 8 branches that are all heads. So you could have done it that way, too. It was a lot easier just to go a half times a half times a half. You didn't have to really draw the tree. There's only one formula for this, folks. Why wouldn't you write it down? All right, let's do it for this one. What's the chance in 6 flips that you'll flip 6 heads in a row? Well, think about it. Chances are it's not going to happen too often. It is possible. Heck, it's possible to flip 1,000 heads in a row. It probably won't happen in the history of the universe, but it is possible. So, you know the rule here. You're going to just multiply all the probabilities together. They are completely independent. You just multiply all the probabilities together. So the probability of this and this and this and ahead and ahead and means multiply, give her. So in the top is going to be all ones. I like fractions. Unless you like these hokey decimal things, 5/10, 0.5 raised to the 6. So, you know what? You can do this one in your head, right? 1 out of 64. Whereas this is going to be some funky number like, right? That's just weird. Who the heck likes those kind of numbers? I'd much rather do that, right? I can picture 1 slice of a 64 chunk birthday cake, but I can't picture, 15,625 hundred thousandths of a birthday cake. That's the proper way to say that, by the way. Next slide. All right, how about if we flip 12 pennies? Well, guess what? You're flipping twice as many pennies, but it's not twice as... It's not half the chance. It's actually... Oh, it's going to be such a tiny number. All right, here we go. So the probability of the first head, and the probability of another 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 head. So anytime you get the word and, because you want a head, and a head, and a head, and a dot, 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 dot. You want 12 heads in a row, I'm just going to go dot, 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 because I'm not writing them all down. Didn't we just say there's a formula for that? Don't you multiply them together? What's a half of a half of a half of a half times a half times a half? All right, just do that on your calculator, all right? And I do fractions, so you're going to find out that it's... right, the top is going to be 1, the bottom is going to be 12 2s multiplied together, which is going to be 4,096, and that's good by me. So there's a 1 chance out of 4,096 that you could flip 12 coins, 12 heads in a row. If we were to pull out 12 coins and flip them, if we did it 4,096 times, one of those times, they should all come up heads. But I didn't feel like doing that myself. You could simulate it, or you could do that. And now if you do it as a decimal, oh my God, look at the number you get. This is disturbing. End up with 2.44140625 times 10 to the negative fourth. So you still got to move the decimal 4 places to the left. So you got to go like that. It's such a tiny number, the calculator can't even calculate it for you. So it ends up being that amount. All right, it's a tiny... I can picture this a lot better. I can picture one slice of a 4,096 slice birthday cake. But I can't picture this. This is just disturbing. For those folks that like decimals, you're a better man than I, I'll tell you. Next slide. Let's try 4 flips. Ah, but now I'm saying, what's the probability of flipping at least one head? So the probability of at least one thing happening, believe it or not, is 1 minus the probability that it never happens. So the probability you'll get at least one head, so one head, or 2 heads, or 3 heads, or 4 heads, is going to be that. So the sneaky way to calculate it is just to subtract the complement. So I'm going to calculate the probability that it's all tails. So the probability that it's all tails is going to be 1 out of 16. So if I want to know the probability that it's not all tails, wouldn't that be some heads? So all I'm going to do is subtract the instance when it was all tails. So if I have 1 minus the times that it's no heads, the opposite of no heads is some heads. It's not one head, right? And we actually simulated it, and we had the computer do it, and it actually grabbed... Look at that, right? It turns out that we actually flipped coins hundreds of times on the calculator. And look at that. That for every 16 times, one of them, it was no heads, and the other 15 times, it was some heads. So like one head, 2 heads, or 3 heads. So no heads is the same as all tails. You got to pay attention to this. You might want to rewind. Next slide. All right, then we did some simple I equals PRT. This was grade 11 stuff. I'm just going to accelerate through this. We did this lots. All right, if you're not writing down the formula, then I don't know what to tell you. So you write down the formula, you plug in the numbers, you flip all the other numbers to the other side to get the thing you want by itself. So it ends up being 2 years. All right, next slide. You write down the formula, you plug in the numbers. Now don't forget, 6 months is really half a year. You've got to put years in there, half a year. So then you tidy up the numbers, right? I know that Right? You tidy up the numbers. If you got a 1,200 and a 1/2, I combine them and call them 600, and then you try to get rid of the numbers here to put them over here, so I divide both sides by 600. You end up with that. Good, the R is all by itself. You've solved for the R. Right, that's old news. We did lots of this in grade. We spent 2 weeks doing this in grade 11. That's enough of that stuff. Ah, let's do it this way now. All right, so now we'll do a compound interest. So read and do. So let's do the compounded. So let's do it simple first. So simple, you know, simple's not going to be very good. So you put in $2,500. At 7.5% for 16 years, you're saving for your daughter's education. Oh, but guess what? It's not $2,500. Well, I hope all the mummies and daddies out there know that if you throw $2,500 in the bank, the government throws in an extra $600. I sure hope you know that. Right? It's kind of nice to do that. And they do that every year. Why wouldn't you go for that? All right? Anyway. So you didn't, even though you put in $2,500, the government throws in the extra $600, and you do all that fancy arithmetic. It's not math; it's just arithmetic. So you end up with interest of $3,720. You add that to the $3,100 that you put in there, right? You put in $25, the government put in $6, and you end up with $6,820 for your daughter's university in 16 years. And that'll pay for, let's see, in Manitoba, that'll pay for a year and a half or two of tuition, right? As long as they're living at home, then, you know, you don't have any apartment to pay for or anything. They might still need a job. Most students have a job, for goodness sake. Now let's calculate it with compound interest, all right? So compound interest, and I said to do it quarterly, so there's the secret formula. That's old news. We did this for weeks and weeks. $10,254. There you go. So it turns out you're probably better to put it in a compound savings account, because a simple is only going to give you this, whereas a compound is just like when you work for Uncle Leo for a penny. Then, yeah, that's a lot better. Anyway, and if you don't like doing that, don't worry, because there's an app for that. There's apps all over the place, but the app we're going to use is we're going to use the one on the calculator. Or use the one on the internet. There's a dozen of them on the internet. Do the same thing. There you go. So you plug it into the calculator, and look, it gives the exact same answer when you round it as this one, right? 10,254. 10,254. So if you didn't like doing this, just make sure you know how to use the calculator. We've been using the calculator for a week now. Hopefully you're keeping up. All right, so hey, now we actually get to do a lesson. Wow, it's kind of nice when you actually learn something new. All right, let's give her. Because you were supposed to have read this on the weekend. All right, so let's go. All right, so mutually exclusive. We looked at the idea of mutually exclusive. So if I said, look at all the events, or look at all the outcomes, rather, where the sum of your dice is 8. Well, there you go, right there. I see 5 of them. And look at all the events where you're rolling a sum of 4. So here's all the events where the outcomes have a sum of 4 right there. And notice that there aren't any 4s that are 8s. Do you know any 4s that are the same as an 8? I don't know any. All right. And then I said, now let's look at the event of rolling doubles. So show me all the outcomes there that are doubles. Boom, right there. Ah, notice that some of the 8s are also doubles. And some of the sums of 4 are also doubles. Turns out that'll be important. All right, so we say that event, so well, you can read this. I'm not going to read it to you. All right, next slide. You're supposed to have read all this anyways. You're supposed to have read all that. Next slide. Yeah. You're supposed to have. Oh, okay, well, you can do this, right? If I say we're going to draw a heart, or we're going to draw a 6. Well, you know what? Those are not mutually exclusive, because there is a 6 that is a heart. So since there are some hearts that are 6s, then you can't say those are completely exclusive things, right? Well, what if I said we're going to draw a black card and a diamond. All right, so how many black cards do you know that are diamonds? I don't know too many black diamonds, except for maybe cheese. So they would be mutually exclusive, because I don't know any black diamonds. So there's no members of the black set that are the same as the diamond set. So since the two sets have no intersecting or common outcomes, or then you'd call them mutually exclusive. They got nothing to do with each other. How many pairs of runners are there that are also black? Oh, yeah. Sure, I know lots of... I got some black runners. How many persons in prison that are innocent of a crime? Well, okay, I guess that was a dumb question. Apparently, there might be some people that are innocent in prison. We could have asked the question kind of backwards. How many people are guilty that are not in prison? That might be a better question. How many people do you know that are under 20 that are also over 40? Now, those are mutually exclusive sets, right? There is nobody who's under 20 that is also a member of the over 40 branch. How many red poker cards and are also spades? Well, I don't know any red spades. So since there are no red cards that are spades, you'd say that, probably being cute and having blue eyes, etc. All right, so you can do all that. And it just becomes important when you're counting your outcomes because, well, here. I said, what's the probability that you reach into a deck and you draw a card that is black or a 9? So, if you're reading ahead, you've already seen all this. What's the probability when you reach into a deck that you pull out a card that is black or a 9? Well, I think I've said often enough that or means add. So, you're going to calculate the probability of black, which is half of the cards. And you're going to add the probability that it's a 9. And I hope you know there's 4 9s in a deck of cards. But now this is where you've got to subtract. All right, you've got to subtract the black 9s. Because you already counted all the black cards, which included the 9s. So you can't double count. So you're going to have to take away 2 of the black 9s. Otherwise, you were double counting them. So you end up with, well, 7 out of 13. Anyway, there's where we got to. You were supposed to have been reading all of this stuff here. All right? That was your job. That's all you had to do for the weekend was read 5 pages. We're going to do bits of the assignment tomorrow. Complete